So good morning. It really is a pleasure to be here for on many different counts. I've been here several times. Actually, the faculty was about 30 years ago when I was a younger individual and was in New York at Sloan Kettering, and I came to visit Dr. Belzer for the possibility of a job here at the University of Wisconsin. I arrived, it was in the winter time. It was rather nice in New York that particular winter, so I arrived, I think, in a raincoat with lining and was so cold. Dr. Belzer picked me up at the airport himself in a little short sheepskin coat. I've never forgotten it. We got to his car, which was a Jeep, unheated, near as I could tell, and I could not stop shivering, and my teeth were chattering. And so he'd ask me a question about the flight or about something else. I couldn't talk to him. I could either shake my head no or shake my head yes. We went to his home. His wife was there, Marion, and we had a fire. We had a nice time. And later, my wife came out, actually, as we looked at the job a second time. But we were both born and raised in Philadelphia on the East Coast and chose to stay there. But I've never forgotten that visit and his kindness to me. And I, you know, have had the chance of being Rickers' friend for a long time. Craig is as well. So I've had the chance to see three different chairs here at this institution, the Department of Surgery. And I would say each time that I've had the chance to visit here, the department is larger, it's stronger, it has a greater national renown, it has developed new and, in my view, innovative opportunities within the department that spread beyond what we consider just classical surgery. And I think in my view, the hallmark of there are many hallmarks of a leader, one of which, though, is a cheerleader. And last night I had the example of that as Craig introduced me to many of the chiefs of divisions here. And the entire evening was not about him, but was about all of them, and then about the faculty and the residents and what you all do here. And so I think that's a great sign of leadership. So I think this department is continues to be one of the very best in the country. I thought I would talk about this not because I'm a transplant surgeon, but for much of my career I was interested in the liver. And I kid the medical students as I talk to them in their first year in anatomy and their second year in pathophysiology about the importance of the liver. For all of you metabolizing a bagel, I'm not sure bagels are here on the East Coast. But let me go forward a little bit of this. I do have some disclosures. I chair the fundraising committee for the Gift of Life in Philadelphia. I donate some money to them. I run the 5K. If I were completely disclosed things, I walk part of the 5K. And some of the slides you will see are from UNOS and my friend Howard Nathan, who is the director of UNOS. For some reason, all of them have Gift of Life on them, but I that's a technical thing, and I'm a little challenged that way. So if you look at hepatocellular carcinoma, at least in a broad view worldwide, it's the third leading cause of death, and most of that is going to be due to either hepatitis B or hepatitis C. A large number of individuals have no concept that they have had hepatitis B or C, if you look worldwide. And there is some controversy about aspects of hepatocellular carcinoma as to whether or not resection, transplantation, bridges to transplantation, etc., should be used. And there are all sorts of issues that relate to outcomes for this, recurrence, cost, and the shortages of donors. But here in the United States, about 3.5 to 4 million people are infected with hepatitis C. 75% have genotype 1, and cirrhosis occurs over time in about 25 to 35%. We believe that in the years to come, the peak will occur of those who develop hepatocellular carcinoma due to a variety of causes. Now, one of the things that's been exciting in the treatment of hepatitis C, for which, as you know, there is no vaccination as there is for A and B, has been the evolution in the pharmacologic treatment of this particular problem. Back in the late 80s, interferon came along. It was a drug which was administered daily subcutaneously. And I'll talk later about that. A subsequent stage had the drug ribavirin added to it. Subsequently, pegylated interferon came along. And pegylated interferon is interferon, but in a different form that allows an injection once a week instead of either daily or three times a week. And then a number of other drugs, as you've seen for HIV and others, protease inhibitors, polymerase inhibitors, and then in recent times, direct-acting antiviral drugs. And if you look in 2014 at the New England Journal of Medicine, specifically in these dates of April and May, over that five-week period of time, five to six articles about these newer treatments with direct-acting antivirals. And suddenly, instead of about a 10% response rate, response meaning a sustained viral response, suddenly you're in the 90 to 99% response rate with several of them, and you can see the results and read that as well as I can. The trials looked at the combinations of the trials. They looked at a shorter term versus a longer term, and they looked at genotypes 2 and 3 in addition to genotype 1. But suddenly, there's new hope for people. And this 3.5 to 4 million people in the U.S. who are infected have some new hope. What's seen on the very bottom of the slide, however, is the $80,000 cost for a treatment course. Now, who would you then screen? Because prior to this, no value in screening. If you only have an opportunity to help people in the 20 to 30% range, you screen me. You screen the individual born between 1945 and 1965. 45% or nearly half of these individuals of me report no particular risk. And there's no correlation between the genotype or the level of the virus in the blood and the progression of disease. So you screen those people who are at high risk. Might be the trauma patients that you see here, those who have used drugs in the past or other individuals who would be at an increased risk. Now, if you look at the management of this, hepatitis B and C can develop hepatocellular carcinoma in a variety of ways. You can see a single lesion, it can be small or large, you can see satellite lesions. Frequently, you will see portal venous invasion and microinvasion as well. Now, this particular lesion in the right lobe was treated this way, but there are other opportunities and some controversies about it, and I'll talk about that now. So in patients who are Child's A with a good score and the absence of significant portal hypertension, bilirubin being low, again, depending on the size of the resection and no extrahepatic invasion, liver resection may well be the first opportunity for these individuals for cure. You assess the patient in a variety of ways, from looking at biochemical indices to their MELD score to looking for evidence of portal hypertension. Some go on to biopsy the what appears to be normal liver to look at the degree of cirrhosis and fibrosis that occurs. Some measure, you should measure the functional liver reserve of the, and you do that here because I remember visiting with the Society of Clinical Surgery some years ago, and that was already being done. Some have gone to measure the wedge venous pressure within the liver, platelet count larger than 90,000, and in Asia they frequently use ICG clearance as well. But it's known that hepatocellular carcinoma, in contrast, say, to metastatic colorectal cancer in the liver, that hepatocellular carcinoma metastasizes via the portal venous system. Some have argued, therefore, that you should do an anatomic resection in order to improve disease-free survival. For tumors smaller than 2 centimeters, a wedge resection and some would even argue RFA or other means can be used. The operative mortality, depending upon the degree of the cirrhosis in good centers, is less than 5%, and the disease-free survival about 40% on average. Now, what about the use of robotic or laparoscopic surgery? They're pretty similar. Operative times in a report in 2014 by the group in Pittsburgh, the operative time, the total OR time longer with the robotic. One difference was that the major complex resections tended to be achieved with robotic surgery versus laparoscopic, but in this particular series, only 5% of the patients had cirrhosis. So there's not as much knowledge about the treatment of hepatocellular carcinoma in the presence of a cirrhotic liver. Now, when you look at this issue of resection initially versus liver transplantation, there are a number of things that are of value. One is looking at the histology of the tumor itself, its differentiation. And this is true for most solid tumors. The poorly differentiated do more poorly. Those with microinvasion do more poorly still. Early survival is similar, particularly when you use intention to treat analysis. In contrast to just looking at those who have undergone, for example, transplantation, where clearly survival is better, recurrence is less, and again, we'll talk about that with a few slides subsequently. The issue of intention to treat has a major component of the waiting time for transplantation. About 20% of people will not recur at 5 years after resection. The flip side of that is 80% will. In these papers that I've cited here, that overall disease-free survival was somewhat similar, 60 to 77%, and as you can see, overall survival or disease-free less at 56 to 40%. But there is clearly decreased local recurrence after transplantation. When you look in some larger series that have been recently published, there are some differences between hepatitis B and hepatitis C in both the type of malignancies that are present and their intrahepatic spread. Hepatitis B tends to be more larger tumors in the presence of cirrhosis. Hepatitis C tends to have much more microvascular invasion and satellitosis around it. There's a better survival for resection with hepatitis B compared to C as the origin of the disease. Transplantation is better for B than C. And when you look at recurrence, there are some differences at 2 years with those with hepatitis B being about 44% and those with C being 55% recurrence. And the same thing is true with transplantation. So it is more difficult in treating patients with hepatitis C-associated hepatocellular carcinoma because of these factors. Now, you can use resection as a bridge to transplant, and you can consider that in regions that have long waiting times, and I'll discuss that in a moment. The decision depends a lot upon the tumor size, the location within the liver, and the functional reserve of the liver, importantly. There are also adverse pathologic factors, such as microinvasion and poor differentiation, as I've said, that might prompt one to do transplantation as the initial treatment. Now, salvage liver transplant is possible and certainly has been reported. It is a little more difficult after the patient's been previously operated upon, particularly with substantial portal hypertension present. But the overall disease-free survival can be achieved and can be good in those circumstances. There are other bridge strategies to transplantation. TACE or transarterial chemoembolization can be used. It doesn't appear to reduce survival, to improve survival, but it may reduce local recurrence with resection, certainly, or with transplant. RFA can be used as well. It is better with smaller lesions, as it is with colorectal metastases. Yttrium has been used. There's some problems with the ability of yttrium to transverse the liver and become systemic, and the radioisotope itself can affect the bone marrow. And some more experience is needed with yttrium, I believe. What about surgery versus ablation? Well, the problem with most of the papers here is that there are few really good randomized trials, in fact, none that I'm aware of, with surgery versus ablation. And so the bias of the individual surgeon treating the patient saying, you should be ablated, you should undergo resection, is clearly present. If you look in general, those that are treated with embolization, chemoembolization, or ablation of using RFA, the retreatment or recurrence is quite high, but for the reasons I've stated. Now, many early on began using the Milan criteria for transplantation for malignancies, hepatocellular carcinoma, using the bilirubin, creatinine, INR, etc. And in fact, that's done with many centers. 25 to 35% of all transplants in Europe and in the United States are done for hepatocellular carcinoma, and the survival's good. It is anywhere from 65 to 80%, with a recurrence rate of about 11%. But again, when you use intention to treat analysis, which is an important way to sort through data, the survival is only 50 to 60% because of the duration of the wait list and those patients that die while on the waiting list. California, UCSF has expanded the criteria some by increasing for them the size of the primary lesion and the number of others, and it's expanded the pool of patients that are eligible by 5 to 10%. Their results are good. Pittsburgh's used a TNM criteria and has added to it tumor differentiation and microinvasion. But this expansion of criteria of eligibility for transplant has been important for patients with hepatocellular carcinoma. When you look at recurrence after transplant, it is predominantly elsewhere. It's in the lung. It is elsewhere in the abdomen, but it's also in the transplanted liver about a third of the time. And as you can see, there are a number of factors that are below here that show or can be correlated with recurrence, such as invasion, the grade, the size, the AFP, and some have even used the neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio as well. And in fact, that ratio started to be used for other types of solid tumors. Now, one of the issues that we deal with in the United States and elsewhere in the world is the number of patients that are waiting for a transplant. Most, if you look at the 123,000 people that are waiting, most of those are going to wait for a kidney transplant. And the largest number of patients who will die waiting are for those for a kidney transplant. They do have dialysis. You do not have dialysis for liver, and about 16,000 people are waiting in the United States currently for a liver transplant. How long do they wait? About a year. For those with liver, as shown here in the middle bar, it's about a year. For those with kidney, it's out about 4 years, and dialysis hopefully sustains them throughout that four-year period of time. But for liver transplant, it's about a year, and you can see the numbers on average for the other organ sites. When you look by age and what's happened over time, in this particular graph from 1993 out through 2013, in those that are young, less than 18, or children, in those that are up to about age 34, it's been rather steady. There's been a large increase on the waiting list in those over the age of 35. That have increased in the blue, those of an older age, 65 plus, and the largest increase of those in the 50 to 64 years. So the waiting list continues to increase. Sadly, 6,000 individuals died in 2013 waiting for a transplant. About 1,500 of those were waiting for a liver transplant. One of the issues relates to donor availability, and this varies by region greatly. When you look at this, the darker areas are the donation rates that are increased. And you can see that certain areas of the country have pretty good donation rates, as shown here. And there are other areas of the country, some of these that are purely white, have almost none, but other areas and yourselves are in this range are actually pretty good in the OPO here. The other issue, though, is who gets transplanted within these various areas, and what's the MELD score? And as you know, as the MELD score increases for an individual patient, they move more to the top of the list and get transplanted more quickly across the United States. In some areas, Pennsylvania on the eastern side, for example, where I am, the MELD score on average is greater than, equal or greater than 29. In other areas, here you are in Wisconsin, it's closer to 23 or 24, but I'm sure there'll be either some comments afterwards about that here. If you look down in southern Florida, the MELD score is less than 23. And it doesn't necessarily correlate directly with the donation rates from those particular regions. So there is a disparity, and consequently, patients sometimes try to get listed in multiple areas or move to a certain area of the country where they may be transplanted a bit early. And there are now political battles ensuing over the issue of equality and justice, if you will, amongst UNOS and how to correct some of these disparities, not in donation rates, harder to do, but in the distribution of organs. And some of that came, obviously, from the work done here at this institution with the use of preservative solutions, and I'll say more about that later. But one of Dr. Belzer's hallmarks, of which he's well known for, and you all know that, is the solution that preserves organs to allow for a greater distribution over distance. Now, I've just shown a couple of things in this table. That it's a very busy table, but here we are in Philadelphia in the Gift of Life, and I've added this down here for Madison, Wisconsin. The populations are very different, 3 million versus 10 million. But if you look at the donors per million population up here, it's not that different. We're at 43, you're at 37. So they've done a good job in Wisconsin in this OPO in getting people to agree to donate. You had a governor who was Tommy Thompson, who was important in that, but a large number of people in this area as well. And the number of transplants per million people, really quite similar, 117 or 118 there and 123 down here per million people. The deceased donor population, however, is getting older and getting sicker. As we heard this morning at the M&M conference, our patients are getting older and getting sicker with a lot more comorbidities. And here there's the age has increased, the degree of the percentage of those with obesity, diabetes, hypertension has increased, and so has the use of donors that are more marginal. Those that are over 70 years of age or non-heartbeating donors, those who have hepatitis C, being transplanted into recipients that are hepatitis C positive. Outcomes actually similar to those who are non-hepatitis C positive. And those that have cancer, but in certain specific and select areas. So the use of marginal donors has helped to a degree to reduce this difficult waiting period for people. And here at your institution, you've used donation after cardiac death, an evaluation tool which is now used actually throughout the United States. And using this particular tool, you are able to predict the suitability for donation after cardiac death. So it's something else that UW has done that has made a tremendous impact in transplantation here in the United States. But there's a rather small, while there's a rise of these types of organ donors, it's only a small percentage when you consider the 8,000 here. Nevertheless, if you look at this rise, it accounts for at least a bit of this increase here that you see since 2004. And it now accounts, as the lower area says in yellow, about 15% of donors are of this category. The survival for patients, about the same, pretty much with age, except those over 65. Retransplant, of course, is worse than the initial transplant. And there's some differences in donor status, obvious differences in MELD score as well. It's an interesting thing that if you look at outcomes for complex surgery, esophageal resection, Whipple resection, hepatic resection, that the literature over the last 20 years has been replete with looking at volume and outcomes, centers with higher volumes having better outcomes. That's not true for liver transplantation. I think there are a number of reasons for that. Training of the surgeons is certainly one, the multidisciplinary approach, and holding the transplant center to certain benchmarks of quality have also made a difference. So even those with a lower volume, in fact, have pretty good outcomes. And there's some controversy about changing this issue of donor distribution, of organ distribution, because those with low volumes, with the changes that have been suggested, may in fact lose their transplant center. So there are a number of ways to increase liver transplants. One is, of course, increase the number of individuals willing to donate. Use of marginal donors. You can do living-related partial organ transplants or artificial organ xenografts or even synthesized organs. But there are some other ways, and this goes back to the conversation at the M&M conference this morning about who talks to a patient or their family, I should say, who talks to the family about that patient undergoing an autopsy. Or who talks to the family about that patient in the ICU and the donation of their organs with their death, with the withdrawal of life support? Frequently, it's the residents who are present in the intensive care unit or the surgical team, if you will. So at Temple, we went about, and Amy Goldberg was the lead author of this study, in which they went about trying to train the residents. We used individuals from the Gift of Life. We used our simulation center there for some of this, which is used for not only technical skill training, but it's used for communication skill training. And so we had a group who was trained, a group that was not. We looked over time to see what happened, and we saw that the SICU organ donation rate increased substantially over a period of a couple of years. We then decided to try, and Amy did, I should say, decided to do this at five other centers that were level one trauma centers, particularly, with 140 residents. And we talked about their ability to initiate a conversation, willingness to do this, how did they define brain death, the confidence in their ability to talk to a family, and what happened in donor rates, and the same kind of thing with training. That is, the post-training, their ability to initiate a conversation, to define brain death, to be confident in their ability to talk to another person about this increased, as did donation rate. So I think this is one rather simple and not very costly way to do this. So in summary, what's happened? There's been a marked improvement in the drug therapy for hepatitis C. It has now allowed screening to become part of our armamentarium, and I think thereby reduce the occurrence of hepatitis C-associated carcinoma of the liver in the 2020 to 2030 decades. The management of early-stage hepatocellular carcinoma is controversial, and you'll see those that want to resect right away and those that think, no, wait, put on the list and transplant. The operative mortality is clearly improved since the 60s. Tom Starzl started a lot of this in organ transplant, as you know, in this country. Better organ preservation at this institution and improved perioperative management and immunosuppressive agents have clearly made a major difference. Now, the UNOS uses the MELD and PELD for pediatric patients to predict the short-term risk of death. It combines these concepts of medical utility and justice, but it doesn't necessarily equalize supply and demand maybe not patient outcomes if you look across the United States broadly. And there have been calls by some to change the current distribution system. There is opportunities to increase organ donation from a variety of ways, and of course research is always vitally important. Now I'd like to change for a moment, if you will, and just talk about the other side of the table. This one in the first part of this talk is the one we're most comfortable with, the one we deal with all the time. So I'd like to talk not about the professor, surgeon, or the chair, but about me. You know, my medical career started as most of yours did. I enjoyed every single clinical clerkship I was on except for psychiatry. And I later became dean, and I should have paid a lot more attention to psychiatry than I did. But I went into surgery like probably many of you. My mentor through college, actually, and then through medical school was Stan Dudrick, who developed total parenteral nutrition. And later down in Houston where I trained was Ted Copeland, who became president of the College of Surgeons. Both of these men are really incredible and great leaders in surgery. My late wife Mary and I were married between my second year in medical school and my third year, and we had one child in medical school when our son, who was the oldest one, when I was in my fourth year. When we went to Houston and I started training, we had one son. When we left Houston to come back and we came to New York, we had four. So this every third night on call, you still can have a family life. I say that actually for the PGY ones and twos. When I started training in the 70s, blood on the gown was actually a badge of courage. It wasn't a dirty gown. If you think about it, MASH was on TV. Vietnam was in its height. We didn't know about hepatitis C. We knew there was something called a non-A, non-B, but didn't know what it was, didn't know how it was transmitted. And so things were different back then. This isn't 1492, as my kids believe I came about, but it was a bit different than now. We used, believe it or not, wire sutures to close the fascia, because in Texas at that time, it was believed they were non-allergenic, if you will, that the fascia like that. And they didn't hurt the patient, but they hurt you if you tied them. You cut your fingers, it went right through your gloves. I was stuck so many times as a surgeon, I couldn't pick out a single time that that happened. And Sharp's precautions were really quite different then than they are now, to the credit. You know, I learned that I was hepatitis C positive from a blood donation. I donated blood in about 1989 or so, and got a little postcard back from the Red Cross that said that I had had a positive test and I better check into it. And I did. I was at the University of Pennsylvania at the time, and so I had a hepatologist there who was also a good friend, and we had shared many patients, and I began then a whole series of trials, first with interferon, 3 days a week getting injected, and then ultimately with interferon and ribavirin, and then subsequently with pegylated interferon and ribavirin. I don't know. I hope that most of you in the audience are fortunate not to never receive interferon. It is a substance that your body produces when you have a virus, when you have a bad flu. And receiving it is like you have a bad flu almost all the time. You have night sweats, you have fevers, you have aches and pains, you get insomnia, you lose some weight, food doesn't taste the same. And it's not a good drug. So when you think about it sometimes for patients with melanoma or in other situations, it's really not a very good drug at all. It was odd because I wrote at that time, and I would lecture at that time, about the treatment of metastatic colorectal cancer to the liver and about hepatocellular carcinoma, knowing that I had a risk for the development of that. And I knew that in contrast to Prometheus, my liver would not necessarily regenerate too well. Ultimately, I did develop a hepatocellular carcinoma. I was treated with radiofrequency ablation. I went on a transplant list, and I got a call one night at home in Philadelphia after I had left New York. And the call was from a nurse who said, there is a donor available. Oddly enough, the week before, I was at Thomas Jefferson lecturing about liver resection for treatment, surgical management of tumors of the liver. And I got a call then saying I was a backup recipient. But that call came at 8 o'clock and asked me if I was ready to receive the transplant. And it's very interesting because I still, as you can tell, get a little emotional about that, because that question came and I stood there for a few moments. To me, a few moments, I guess to the nurse, it was, you know, 10 or 15 seconds, but I thought about it. And my wife had developed cancer prior to that, and you know, a whole variety of different things. So I said yes, called my wife upstairs, she came down, we hugged for a while, we went off to the hospital in the middle of the night. The events surrounding the operation, you know, are somewhat blurred, you know, even immediately afterwards, but certainly blurred at this point in time. But I can tell you a few things. One is that the person I remember the most was the nurse going into the operating room, which was seen to me about like Wisconsin. It was so cold. And she brought a warm blanket, and so I thought she was truly a Florence Nightingale. The other, and I use that now in my care of patients, make sure they're warm. And that includes being in an examining room in a little thin gown that looks like it was developed by, Attila the Hun. I don't know what these gowns are like. But the next one was the intern who removed the drain, the Jackson Pratt drain, at least the first one. And as he removed that, I lifted up a little bit off the table. The second time, the second drain, he used a little bit of lidocaine. It was much easier. And the intern that removed the nasogastric tube remained my best friend. I did have an interesting experience about the second day because they removed the Foley catheter. And the nurse on the floor came in to ask, have you urinated yet? Have you voided? I said, no, and this went on. And finally, she said, well, you know, it's been about 6 hours. If you don't urinate by 6 o'clock tonight, I'm going to put a Foley catheter back in you. So she came in about 6 o'clock and said, have you voided? And, of course, I did what most people, well, I don't know of most people, but I did what I did, and I lied. I said, sure. I said, absolutely, it was terrific. She walked into the bathroom, and she said, well, where is it? I said, and of course, I and you know, I had tried all these things with putting the sink on and et cetera. None of that did any good. But I did ultimately void and did fine. The other thing that I learned is that the house staff come in at 6 a.m., of course, as they do here, and they would they'd examine you and they would touch me. They'd look at the bandage that was here and we'd talk. And the attendings would come in later on rounds, and there would be 10 to 12 people with them. And they're nice people. They're friends. But they didn't as much. It was the house staff that did. And the attendings would, as we tend to do, pontificate to the house staff and answer questions. They would ask my questions. But there wasn't a lot of touchy-feely that went on. So it taught me a little bit more about the touchy-feely part. Whether or not I have a long tie or a bow tie, I wash my hands or use the creams that you have on the hallways, but I do try to touch people. Even if I'm touching their toes, even if I touch it through a blanket, there's some sort of a association. So that's the other thing that I learned, is how important it is to touch people. I was eager to get out. I just wanted out of that hospital. So I hobbled up and down the hallways with drains and tubes and other things coming out of me. And I got out on the fifth day. So it was good. I got home. The potholes on the ride home were impressive to me. I do remember that. But I was very grateful to be alive. I thought a lot about the donor and the donor's family. And about a year after the transplant, I got a note that comes through the gift of life from the donor's mother. And so I read it, I cried, I wrote back to the donor's mother, and I've done that now a couple of times. And it made me pause a lot to think that someone had died so that I could live. So I asked myself a lot about this over time. Am I very different now than I was? And I think in some ways I am, and in some ways I'm not. I mean, when I was dean, I still worried about budgets. I let the minutiae of life interfere with what was really important or in time and at that time. I do think about our patients, my patients, differently. They're not just a complex case, and people talk about this all the time. We do. They're not just a case, and it's not just about them, but it's about the patient within the setting of their family and their job and all the aspects of their lives, which we don't often think about. We think about the effects of cholecystitis on them, on their pain, or do they have jaundice, or do they have cholangitis? But we rarely think that they have a job, they have a family, they're worried about themselves, they're worried about continuing with their job, and we don't take that into account as much. The great injustice in all of this is that so many people wait, and there's so few organs that can be transplanted. So, I do what I said here. I donate some money. I run and walk the 5K. And I talk to you all and some other people, other audiences, if I can, a little bit to increase donor awareness, because I think that's terribly important. And I think it's important to support organ donation. I notice in the lobby of your hospital here, you have Donate Life there. I have a little green bracelet that reminds me about all of this. I do think that, at least for me, I'd like to leave things a little bit better than where I found them. That was true when I was at Penn. It was true at Cornell with Craig. I did leave things better because I was able to recruit him from Boston, and that they made things a lot better at Cornell, quite frankly. So at the end here, what I'd like to do is quote from a poem by Mr. Joseph Kralichek. He wrote a small poem called The Courage. It's actually in a book, The Courage of One, and the poem's entitled Take the Time. And it goes a little like this. I'm not going to do the whole poem, but it said, I quote, "Did you smell the rose, or did you worry about the pain of the thorn? Do you see the rainbow, or does the rain cloud your view? Do you feel the warmth of the sun, or were you blinded by the light? Your gift, your life, is a gift to share, have you? Treat it as if it is your only gift to share, will you? So see the rainbow, feel the rain, smell the rose, challenge the thorn, feel the warmth, relish the sunrise, share your gift as your gift to others, as if it is all you have to give." So I thank you very much, Craig, for this. I really enjoy it. I think you have a wonderful Department of Surgery here. You have a great leader in this man, and I appreciate very much this opportunity to be with you here today.